The fire this time in Libya and legal issues here at home, this time on Behind the Story. Welcome to Behind the Story. Hello, I'm Richard Lando. We have lots to cover this week. Before we do begin, I'd like to introduce our three guests. First, we have with us Jeffrey Manishen, who's a lawyer with Ross and McBride. Good to have you back.
Nice to be back, Richard.
Joining us again is Lorraine Sommerfeld, who's a columnist with the Toronto Star. Good to have you again. And joining us for the first time from our Edmonton studio, David Staples. David, it's good to have you with us.
Thanks for having me here.
Good to have you. All right, before we talk about the issues around Libya, I'd just like to show you a quick montage. We have a small clip here that shows you some of what's been going on up until the moment Muammar Gaddafi showed up recently with his parasol. Take a quick look.
A violent crackdown on protesters demanding democracy in Libya has left more than 200 dead. Longtime Libyan leader Muammar Gaddafi has not spoken publicly since the protest against his government began. But early Monday local time, his son took to the airwaves, warning that if the violence does not stop, a fierce civil war could erupt.
We'll be crying over thousands. Blood will flow, rivers of blood, in all the cities of Libya.
He called for implementation of democratic reforms.
We have a rare and historical moment to create an extraordinary reform in Libya.
But what exactly those reforms are remain unclear. Those who've already fled Libya are skeptical.
He won't stop. And I think it's high time for the world to step in and tell this man to stop killing.
Well, this program looks at the media and how the media cover these stories. Here's the Toronto Star on the cover. God knows the outcome. God made it onto the cover of the Toronto Star. There you go. The Globe and Mail. Here's Gaddafi. He's wonderfully dressed. I mean, he's got great millinery, too. I am not going to leave this land. I will die as a martyr at the end. You know what that reminds me of? I'll show you in a couple of moments that reminds me of. Globe and Mail had some fascinating headlines. Libyan military widely regarded as murderous thugs. Isn't that a great headline from the Globe and Mail? Here's another one. Libyans witnessing the last lashings of a dying beast. I don't know who's writing the headlines in the Globe. They are good. And another one here, this is the National Post. It's a civil war. They're not waiting. They got different pictures of Gaddafi in different outfits. I mean, he's got great clothing. And finally, a map of Libya. And we'll talk about that in a minute. Map of Libya broken out, and it's only a newspaper can do, broken out by tribe. I want to ask you, Jeffrey, we'll start with you. How well are the media explaining the situation in Libya and beyond?
I think I'd say as best as they can, given the bias that they'd have in favor of a democratic process. So we're going to see the color, we're going to see the effect. The part that's so tragic is the impact on human lives, that you have a state leader turning his militia, his mercenaries, on his own citizens. Mm. But it's not going to stop. It'll clearly get worse before it gets better.
Lorraine?
I think what's really fascinating, especially at this time, is that we've got YouTube and we've got people with their phones from inside. So it's not just journalists who bring that with them. We've also got uprisings from inside. It's usually students where this starts. And I think what's really amazing for the rest of the world, even though it's so brutal to watch, is that we do have untrained people that are just pure witnesses, and they're able to get the footage out. Video is far more effective than anything else. It's the first time, I think, that we're actually seeing in so many hot spots all at the same time and on the ground kind of feedback that's not from traditional news organizations.
Point well made. David, what do you say?
Libya isn't a country that's traditionally covered very much. I doubt there's very many correspondents who are there very often. Very few correspondents would know that much more about the country than is generally known by most people in the West. So it's not an area of expertise for many people going into the story. So, and I think that's been reflected in the coverage. It's been pretty cookie cutter. That said, there are people who are getting news out, just regular citizens who live in Libya. And that makes up for a lot in this day and age.
Good point. And you know, the thing about Gaddafi, let me show you this two-page spread here from the Globe and Mail. It's another thing newspapers do well. There's Gaddafi. I mean, here, look with his cigarette down here. He's a character that I have to say, those of us in the media who cover him go, what a character, larger than life. And you know, my thought about him is when he says he's only going to go out in a blaze of glory. I was thinking of, can you bring up that image, that first picture we have? Tony Montana in Scarface. Say hello to my little friend. I mean, this is a guy going out, he's going to blow everybody up. Gaddafi's just like that. I find he's a caricature.
Well, caricature maybe, but when I hear that kind of talk and appreciating some of the other comments his son has raised with the extreme language, if I had to predict, and it may not count for much, no, he won't go out in a blaze of glory. He'll simply disappear. He will make himself very scarce when it looks like it's time to be able to get out, when it looks like the forces that are pro-democracy, when enough of his army have turned against him, he'll disappear.
You think so?
Yeah, I think Jeffrey's right. There's not going to be a big Hollywood ending for this. He can predict it, but you know what? There's no way.
Are we fizzling toward revolution there, David, or what do you think is going to happen?
Well, it seems like it. It seems like half the country, it looks like there's going to be a civil war if Gaddafi doesn't step down. You know, one thing that the coverage has done of Gaddafi is that because he is painted as a monster, as a Tony Montana kind of character, it's almost like whatever happens to him, he could be shot dead by the CIA, he could be ripped apart in the street by the mob, and we would all be okay with that because he has been demonized to the extent that he has. I'm not saying he doesn't deserve that kind of treatment, but that is the image that we get, and it does create an atmosphere where anything goes with this guy. And I don't really have any serious qualms because of we have an idea that he's a terrible man, but it is something worth thinking about.
Well, go on.
I'm just wondering, kind of piggybacking on that, though, if someone who's had such control over his image for so long, has he not maybe wanted it to be like this?
Yeah, I don't know, but the Globe and Mail characterized him here as the archetypal tyrant, to pick up on what you were saying. I mean, that's really the archetypal tyrant. You got to wonder. I mean, when he came to the UN, I mean, I looked at him. He and Mugabe and the Kim family in North Korea, the world doesn't know how to deal with these guys. And you wonder if they got an illness, if something got into their brain, I'll be polite about it. And you wonder how it is the world doesn't know how to deal with these guys. Well, take them out.
And in fact, actually, Richard, that's the next thing that I'd like to see more coverage from the media on, which is next steps. Assume for the moment that he does disappear, what happens to Libya? Does the Western world intervene and assist in establishing a democratic process? We're starting to see some articles in that regard, what Obama's role should be. That's the area, frankly, for my part, I'd love to read more about and learn more about, because it is that next step that we've got to be thinking about.
I say this is the fast part that happens incredibly quickly in front of our eyes. The next part takes generations, and we tend to look away because we all have ADD and we don't really want to be there for the building.
Yeah.
You know, the tearing down. It's like when they demo a house, they could do it in an hour.
But then it's a question of who's got the role to build. Well, at what stage does it happen? How do you implement it?
David, did you have a chance to see his son on television, Saif, when he was giving his news conference by any chance, or talking on television?
No, I missed that. I guess one thing I would say about all of these things is that, like, I follow the news, but I know very little, and I think most of us know extremely little about Libya. And, you know, in terms of coming up with answers about what's going to happen in that country, like, I always find that you have to go to books. The real experts are writing books on this, and if you're really interested in making that kind of investment where you want to know where this country's been, what it's about, where it needs to go, that's where you're going to find it, by doing some really serious reading. And very few of us are willing to do that on any subject. The last time I did it on a foreign issue was on Islamism and Afghanistan. I knew nothing about that going in, but suddenly I was reading probably read a dozen books on it in quick order after 9/11. So I just think we're kind of somewhat interested in Libya, but I don't think we're really willing to invest that kind of time reading about this country or caring about it that much, frankly.
I think that, you know, that's why I've saved this Libya ethnic map, which you saw in the newspaper. We may bring it up here in a second. You know, you tend to think of a nation as a nation, and you find out it's a polyglot nation, people speaking different languages of different cultures. They're starting to talk about tribes. I find that fascinating because we don't often get exposed to that. And then his son came on television. I could not look away. I watched the entire rant. It was only an hour and a half. It was like watching a train wreck. I couldn't. Saif, there he is, who was on television, giving this talk. And he alternately threatened the people with war, threatened them with poverty, threatened them with death, told them that they were going to transform the nation. It was like a guy who's just been caught by his wife cheating. His baby, please don't go. I'll do anything to make you stay. I'll change. No, you're wrong. He tried everything on television to try and beg the nation. It was a real sight. I've never seen anything like that.
Well, and I think the next step will be what response he gets out of it. And I can't imagine that it would have much sympathy from the people that are opposed to what he and his father have been doing for so long.
Yeah.
So I think it becomes a grab bag. It may be a style. It may be a style of persuasion that might be specific to their country that he may figure will work.
Alternately threatening and begging.
Or it may be desperation.
Yeah, that's what it was.
I think all of this is probably more what David's saying, though, is it's not really one specific country. It's so many of them. It seems like a necklace. It's just one beat after the other the last couple of weeks. And I think that's what's fascinating about all of it. And I mean, David's absolutely right. I don't know much about any of them, but when you take them together, it's like, oh, we better smarten up and we better start reading and learning.
David, I'm going to have you comment first on this next story, which is Irshad Manji wrote a piece in the Globe and Mail where she says, for Arabs, the challenge of democracy starts with the family. And her thesis, it's a think piece, her thesis is that, you know, when Mubarak came on TV and referred to all the people as his children, etc., that it goes back to, a paternalistic, a patrilineal kind of father-driven family image these guys have. What do you think of that statement, that the way she approached it?
Well, on the one side, I thought it was a red herring. She seemed to be complaining about how it's a strong kind of patriarchy in the Arab world where the dad rules with an iron fist, and that runs right up to the top of the government. So that's kind of what everyone's used to. And if you want to change the Arab world, you have to change the patriarchy. That seemed to be what came from our article. I don't agree with that. I think that you can change the society. There's all kinds of things that are going to change it. The internet is a profound influence. Cable TV, these are the freedom of information discussion. You can still have a patriarchy and overthrow the father dictator. So I didn't agree with her argument at all.
Okay.
But I did think it was an interesting thing to find that it was a little bit more about Arab society,
mm-hmm.
Something about it that I didn't know.
Okay.
That's the value I found in it was... it's an interesting take, if only because it gives it a very human angle. Sometimes it's really hard to get a handhold in a lot of these issues because they're so politicized, because they're so volatile. Everyone can identify with a family structure, so I think she took a readily identifiable structure and said, let's start there to at least try and understand people that aren't the same as us, frankly. So.
And I took it just as, not unlike what Lorraine has indicated, it's a hypothesis. But on the other hand, if you have a military leader who comes in, takes power by force, maintains that power with the force, I don't equate that with having been able to occur simply because of a patriarchal structure. It may well be the military force he's taken has simply ruled the roost.
I think she missed the mark. I think we're really talking about tribal society, not the family. I think it's a tribal society. And even when Saif was on TV, he kept saying, we're from this tribe and they're from that tribe. My mother's from this tribe, my father's from that tribe. And he was talking tribal through the entire discussion, so I think she may have missed the boat on that point. Here's another, you said pearls in the necklace. Here's another one here. You're paying attention to Bahrain. You had better. This is David Frum. And you know, the thing is, I didn't realize Bahrain was connected to Saudi Arabia now by a 16-kilometer-long causeway. He mentions it in there. So I thought it was just an island. But I can see why the Saudis might be getting a little nervous, Jeffrey, because it's just down the road. How well do the Western media... explain the nuances of each different nation. Bahrain's not Libya.
And I appreciate David's comments earlier on going from a standpoint of limitation of information. I'm similarly situate. I read From Beirut to Jerusalem years ago by Thomas Friedman, which gave me insight into that one country and that one interrelationship. But these, we're only learning about more as we see the flames of independence spreading like a wildfire going from one country to the next. The information I got on Bahrain from that article was certainly news to me. The concept of being afraid, it looked as though there was a great deal within that country that was positive, that was strong, that was realistic. So I didn't see the basis for his comment on fear.
Yeah.
Was the fear going to be that's the next country to be awash in violence? I didn't quite catch his point in that regard.
Yeah.
I thought it was interesting that almost every other country that we've been talking about that's been in the news, most of the revolts are coming from people repeatedly. They have no water, they have no housing, they're starving, and they have no access to employment. That's where the root of it is. When you read about Bahrain, I mean, I find myself meeting David Frum more lately, which is shocking.
We won't tell anybody. We'll keep it our secret.
But it's like Bahrain's not the same.
No.
And it is right that we have to really understand that these are different countries, and we traditionally don't know a lot about any of them. We lump them all in together. So I think it's would behoove us to pay a little more attention and maybe do a little digging and see if he's right or wrong. I'm not sure yet.
Did he make his point, David? Does Frum make his point in the article?
You know, since I read that article from Frum, I've read more. It suddenly got me interested in Bahrain, so I was reading more. So it's kind of blending together a little bit. But I think one of the things that he was talking about was there's a large Shia minority there, and and whether, you know, will they fall into Iran's grip or not? Or this is one of the issues. So I think he did bring out some interesting facts about Bahrainian society. I always find it interesting, though, like I write a column on City Hall here in Edmonton. To write well, I think, on any issue, you have to be very expert and read a lot about it. And I always find it amazing when someone like David from who's in Washington or wherever he is now, Toronto, he's writing about another country. Just, it strikes me as being kind of audacious to think that you can speak with authority about another country. Now, maybe he's this incredible guy who does have all this knowledge about the entire world, and he can speak with authority and competence about all of these different countries. But frankly, whenever I read someone like him writing about another country in another part of the world, I'm very skeptical of what they have to say.
Uh-huh. Like all Canadians go to Canadian Tire, buy their clothing at Roots and play hockey, yes. I just want to mention as a bit of continuity, we talked last week about the fact that the Toronto Star said it was sending 9 reporters to the hotspots. And here's the kind of what's resulted from it. Star exclusive photo of Bahraini prisoners freed. There's one. And I'll show you another one here. Well, the Star's doing its homework. A kingdom turns against its own. There's more there. As you can see from a report from Bahrain, Oakland Ross from Egypt, so you can see they've been busy. And in the time that remains, I do want to talk to you too about Pakistan, because that's come up in the news as well. I'll start with you, Jeffrey. We've seen unrest in the Muslim world. We've seen pictures like this. Again, here is the National Post with a U.S. flag being burned in Pakistan, and we're told that's the next hot spot. That's the next problem. How well does this kind of story capture the salient points of the instability there?
Right now, it tends to disappear because of what we're seeing in the Middle East. But when you read that story, you certainly become much more enlightened again on the scope and the extent of the problems in that country, not only from an economic standpoint, from a political standpoint, from a leadership standpoint. The level of poverty and the level of volatility, it's the next area that could give rise to a similar type of explosion.
I think the media totally dropped the ball on the natural disasters that have descended on Pakistan. I think that's the number one huge problem, where the media has absolutely turned its back, and so has the rest of the world, frankly. We can talk about all the, you know, just terrible political situations. It's horrendous. The natural disasters,
and that's buried halfway through the story, one paragraph about it. There you go. David, on Pakistan?
It was an alarming article to read. It highlighted all kinds of problems with Islamist terrorists riding motorcycles, assassinating people, starvation, rampant starvation because of the floods there. It just made me, it was painted a very bleak picture of this country. And I wondered in the end if it was alarmist or not. Like if someone from Pakistan read that, would they say, hey, you know, yeah, we have our problems here, but you've just highlighted every bad thing about our country, and there's lots of good things too. Now, I don't know, I can't answer that, but it's the net effect of that article was to make me think this is the worst country in the world, and terrible things are going to happen here, and almost anything's warranted for us to get this country under control. That was the feeling I got in the end from it, and I just don't know if that was fair to Pakistan or not, although I understand the problems there.
Yeah, no, it's not the worst country in the world. That belongs to Somalia. I will read this to you on the way up, because I always figure there's something you can learn from these situations. Where does the name Pakistan come from? Well, read this with me. The name Pakistan was developed by students at Cambridge University in 1933, 14 years before Pakistan actually became a nation. They coined the term Pakistan with letters taken from the local districts, and here they are: Punjab, Afghania, Northwest Frontier Province, Kashmir, Iran, Sindh, Turkestan, Afghanistan, and Baluchistan. The name means the land of the spiritually pure and clean. We'll be back after this break. Call this segment Law and Order, because we're dealing with legal issues, obviously. And we have the interesting incident of Our immigration minister, Jason Kinney, launching an attack, is the word they've used in the Globe and Mail, an attack on federal court judges for rendering decisions that he didn't agree with. He suggested the judges were preventing him from properly administering the immigration program. David, is Kinney out of order or within his rights as a cabinet minister?
He was completely within his rights. He didn't say the judge is crazy, the judge is a nut. He didn't hold the judges himself in contempt. He held the judges' decisions and ideas up to question. Maybe he held those ideas and it was extremely critical of him, but there was nothing contemptuous about his actual attitude towards the judge himself. So they've got to take it. Judges make big decisions in our society. They control the fate of people's lives, and we are allowed to attack their decisions and their reasoning. And they should sit there and respect our right to make such comments. So I fully support Jason Kenney on this.
Okay, Lorraine?
I think my biggest problem with Jason Kenney is when I look at his actions in total rather than just individual stuff. And when he was exercising from the immigration booklet that we have same-sex marriage, and he was making decisions on his own that represent me, that bothered me. As a minister of this government, what he's speaking about represents me as well. So it's not so much that his individual comments once in a while, everyone can say what they want to think. I look at his kind of agenda going back in total, that bothers me.
His body of work, so to speak.
I'm not really impressed.
All right. You're a lawyer, so I'm dying to hear what you think about this.
Sure, and on this one, David, I'll take the right to disagree with you, because I have a lot of difficulty when federal politicians criticize federally appointed judges. I'm concerned about that. I think there is significance to the separation between the executive and judicial branches of our democracy. And when you have a cabinet minister criticizing the way in which a judge does his work, is the unspoken, implicit message going to be, don't worry, when we have a chance to be able to replace him or her, when we have a chance to appoint new judges, they'll do the things we want them to do. They won't come up with rulings that will interfere with the way we'd like to be able to administer our policy. We'll take care of that. There's supposed to be a separation. You don't like the ruling, fine. There is capacity to be able to appeal it. And if ultimately it's appealed to the highest level and you lose, then as a cabinet minister, you lose. That's the role of the judicial process, separate from executive. There have been cases where cabinet ministers and government officials have commented on cases that are before the courts, and it has led to stays of proceedings. I think it's really important for there to be that independence. You can comment, David, on what the judge does. I have trouble with the cabinet minister doing
it. Okay, set me straight on one thing. If he doesn't like what the judge has decided, can he go back and rewrite the laws to circumvent a decision?
Well, he can certainly have his government put that forward.
There you go. Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay. This is an interesting story. Torontonians know this one fairly well. This shopkeeper who basically did what citizens sometimes tend to do, which is regarded as vigilantism, but in his case, it turns out it may not have been. A shopkeeper welcomes changes to citizens' arrest laws. And Toronto shopkeeper acquitted of assault and forcible confinement after he captured a shoplifter, hailed an announcement Thursday that amendments to the criminal code will expand legal protections for people making citizens' arrests or defending their property. And our prime minister came to Toronto and actually appeared at his place to make the announcement about the changes. So is this a gateway to vigilantism or a needed legal remedy? Lorraine, I'll start with you.
I think it's absolutely needed, because what he did, the fact that this poor guy had to go and battle and fight for what he ended up getting. The other thing I found really funny was that all three parties agreed and they still found a way to be all cranky pants with each other about it.
It's crazy, eh? Okay, David? It's a Toronto story, but I'm sure things like this happen in Alberta.
Yeah, I know this. We follow the story here. It was completely reasonable what he did in arresting that guy when he came back to his shop to rob again. He had been robbing there repeatedly, as I understand. So it's sad that they needed to actually change the law to recognize that someone in the prosecution office went ahead with prosecuting this guy. Couldn't they realize this on their own? Did we need a new law? The new law seems fine to me, though, and so more power to the politicians who are making it clear to prosecutors everywhere that you don't charge people for something like this.
All right, just before I come to you, there's the second to last paragraph in the story. It seems buried there was what you were hinting at. The failed Chen prosecution attracted wide media attention, and all three political parties see the issue as a vote-getter among the Toronto electorate. That's kind of buried in the bottom of the story.
Does that mean it splits it, though?
Yeah, well, who knows?
David, on this one, I agree with you. I'm always upset when I see that there's some change to the criminal code because of a specific case. I deal with the sections in the criminal code regularly in the course of my practice as a criminal defense lawyer. And you're right. This was a prosecution that was ill-advised. You don't have to change the code to correct that. You change the exercise of prosecutorial discretion. You learn that we shouldn't have run this. Here's the way that the law is going to read if it's passed. And I love the title of the legislation this government uses. This is called the Citizens Arrest and Self-Defense Act. That's what they call the change to the code.
Okay.
And it's going to change the code to be able to allow citizens to make an arrest, providing they make the arrest at the time they find the person committing an offense or make the arrest within a reasonable time after the offense is committed, and they believe on reasonable grounds that it's not feasible in the circumstances for a peace officer to make the arrest. That's the law that's proposed. What's that reasonable time after the offense was committed?
3 years.
Well, that's one. And how feasible or unfeasible do you have to have your belief as to whether a police officer will or won't respond? How do you ever interpret that? How does an average citizen ever understand that? What's the educational process? What's that going to do? It is going to encourage citizens' arrest in the most far-reaching circumstances. The essence of the criminal code provision is saying you can make the citizen's arrest where you find the person committing the offense. There's no gray area.
Okay.
You found them committing the offense.
Okay, I hear you. I'm going to move on to another story here. I'll start with you, David. Pro-Life Club is suing Carleton University. Carleton Lifeline, the pro-life club at Carleton, has sued the university and its administration for the discriminatory treatment they've been subjected to during this academic year. We showed some of them being shuffled off campus by the police were called to arrest them because they were on campus with a display and a protest. Should they also be suing the Carleton University Students Association, which has decided to delist them as a club? And did the story miss that angle, or was it not important here? What do you say?
I don't think they should be suing anybody. I mean, I think it's well within the university's rights to shut down that kind of thing. It's a public place. We have rules about what you can display in public or not. They didn't meet the rule. You know, the fact that they're being persecuted for it, for their beliefs, this is what happens when you have really strong beliefs. You get in a fight with other people, and it's sometimes a fight is ugly, sometimes you get bruised up a little bit, but I think you should take it on the chin and keep going forward with your cause. You shouldn't be suing people.
Okay.
I don't support them at all.
Lorraine?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I think we circle around this issue constantly.
We
covered it on this show, we've covered it on other shows.
Mm.
It's about the graphic nature of this. It's not the fact that they're merely anti-choice, which they choose to be, and that's fine. It's the graphic nature that they present their cause with, and it's really hard to respect somebody that doesn't respect other people.
Let me see, as something of a network censor, I get to look at what goes on the air here and does not, and some of the programs. Somebody gave me images like that to put on a program, I'd say, no, I can't do it. Yeah.
Sure, and I think what it is, too, picking up what David's indicated, if the institutions, such as the university, have their rules, well, then they have to be followed. And if you want to be able to display material that's highly inflammatory in nature because it advances your cause and that's contrary to the rules, you are going to be stuck with that. You'll have to find some other form. I think the way they sorted this out was to have some materials of a less inflammatory nature displayed indoors as opposed to out in a public setting. This group didn't want to follow the rules.
Yeah, you know, they could end up making more enemies than friends for their cause. That's the marketer in me says that. Okay, Linda Gibbons, the anti-abortion activist who has spent 700 consecutive days behind bars for her refusal to stop picketing in front of a Toronto abortion clinic, will get her case heard in the Supreme Court of Canada, but it does not mean that she will leave jail anytime soon. And she spent an inordinate amount of time in jail for refusing to abide by the order to stay away from the clinic. I'm going to start with you on this one, Jeff. Jeffrey, what are the legal issues involved, and why has this made it all the way to the Supreme Court?
All right. And first of all, I would say that it would look like she has a charter membership in the pro-life club from Carleton University.
She could well.
What happened was several years ago, back in 1994, there was an interim injunction that was obtained by the Attorney General, basically prohibiting people from processing out of centers where abortions are performed.
Mm-hmm.
And what this woman has done over the course of many years is continued to violate the injunction and from time to time has been charged criminally with offenses such as obstruct police officer or other sorts of crimes. More recently, they charged her with breaching a court order. And the way that the law works under the criminal code, if you're the subject, if there's some court order you've breached and there isn't any other specific method to be able to prosecute and punish, then that's the section that fits. The argument the lawyer has advanced here is to say, just a sec, there are rules for punishing civil contempt. There's a procedure for civil contempt.
Fines, this is
that's right, and
a civil
injunction, and there are civil rules. So there is another method. So you shouldn't have gone after her under the criminal code. The civil rules exist. She should have been dealt with under the civil rules. That, well, his argument is this section under the criminal code isn't applicable. And I've read the Court of Appeal decision, which came out last year, and they said, hang on, there are rules for dealing with civil contempt, but no specific statutory punishment.
Where's this
going? And so where it's going, Supreme Court of Canada will have to untangle that legal knot. And I think what they're going to wind up saying, likely, is going to say there aren't specific rules for it. This section's still available. The thing I'm missing, though, Richard, is what about the civil injunction? How come nobody has ever taken steps to try and get that set aside if you believe it shouldn't exist? Okay. That we haven't seen.
Do you have a legal opinion on this?
Well, I'm nowhere near as eloquent as Mr. Manishen.
He's a lawyer.
But I read down, it says for $500, she can shut up and go home. And she chooses not to. So you know what?